Hi, everybody. It's Plastic EP here. Just to tell you, we got a fantastic show, a worldwide special, Super Beatles collectors of the world, and we got some of them here with me today. I want to say a big hello to Guy Smith. And Guy, how are you and where are you coming in from?
Oh, I'm doing good, Plastic. I'm coming from Pennsylvania in the United States.
That's great. We've also got Dennis Daly, and where are you coming in from, Dennis, and how are you today?
Good morning from Nebraska in the United States, EP. Great to be on your show today.
Well, let me tell you, Dennis, it's great to have you, and everybody here is a great Super Beatles collector. And coming in from the UK, of course, Pat Graham. How are you, Pat?
Good morning, EP. I'm great and feeling groovy, yeah.
And That's great, too, and coming in from... Coming in from NASA, we always use that gag, don't we, Terry?
We do.
Where are you coming in from, Terry, again?
I'm in the middle of Southern Illinois, EP, where I'm going to shovel snow when we're done today, so that's good.
Yeah, tell me something, you guys. I've never seen a show like this, Super Beatles Collectors. I can't wait to get into it. So the big question is now, are you feeling groovy?
Yes, feeling very groovy.
Yes, groovy.
Great. From all over the world, here we go.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey, bananas, we want you groovy. Driving chew buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. We love to watch you cause you're our favorite show.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas,
hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you guys are all groovy. Now, straight into it, let's not muck around. Now, I want to ask you, Guy, if I may first. How long did it take you to amass your collection?
I've been an on and off collector. I basically started right after the Beatles broke up. You know, I was 4 years old in 1964 when they first came to America. And I did have a wig and a sweatshirt that from when I was 4 years old. But it was basically about 1972 that I started collecting, mostly records. And it would be on and off throughout my life. The past year, since I've been home most of the time, I got into the memorabilia a lot more than I had in the past. A lot of my memorabilia is from the last year.
Now, Guy, I just want to ask you, with these two photos here, just tell me what that is.
Yeah, that's these were made in the UK, but that's actually a USA display. A sealed display of all the little miniatures that a company called Sabutio did in the UK. I managed to pick that up probably about 5 or 6 years ago from the USA, and it's one of the highlights of my collection.
And Pat, just tell me what this one is too now. This is yours as well, yeah?
Yeah, that's one side of my Beatles room with showing all mainly the cell column Mastro guitars that I've got. I started a bit like Guy. I started in the early 70s collecting because back in 64 I was 6 years old, and my sister got me into the Beatles, really. And I started off with an insignificant the Beatles famous cloth patch that was sold in 63-4, and so that was given to me by my sister. And then I started in the early 70s and have continued ever since, really.
That's amazing. I've got to tell you, in the 60s, I remember that orange drum in the middle there. It had a picture of Ringo on the actual snare drum, like a drawing. And it was so expensive at the time, we couldn't afford it. Now, Dennis, how long did it take you to amass your fantastic collection?
I think the first thing I ever bought was the 45 record, I Want to Hold Your Hand. And I bought that in 1964. I still have it. It's the original piece of my entire collection. And I consciously started collecting memorabilia like these other guys in the early 1970s. Probably the first piece I ever bought was 70, 71 in that area.
Now, Dennis, I want you to tell me as I go through these photos, just go through these items if you can. Here's the first one.
Yeah, that was a great piece that I picked up. That was a full box of what was called the Beatles Hummer. That was like a musical instrument similar to like a recorder. And I was very fortunate to find a full box that had never been opened. And it came with all of the Beatle Hummers that you can see there and the promotional poster. So that was a great find.
That's great. Now I'm going to show some more, Dennis. I know it's a bit awkward. When I put the photo, just try and lean a bit to your right and find that gap as you talk. Just move a little bit in that little square if you can. Just move to one side.
Yeah, those are Beatle disco cases. And what those were a case that you could put your 45 records in and take them to your friend's house or take them to the sock hop or take them to the dance. And also included in that picture, I tried to have all the color varieties of it. And then I also put in some of the promotional pieces, the posters and what have you. The two yellow ones there in the middle, that was a radio station promotion, WTRY, and they put out those disco cases as a promotion. And then the cardboard boxes, those were the original shipping boxes that those disco cases would have been shipped into to a retail center somewhere.
That's amazing. Now let's move on to these ones. As I said, once I show the picture, Dennis, if you can just move to one side, I think it's that side, if you can just go in the gap.
Okay.
Oh, well, that one you can't, but you'll see a gap. All right. Now, that's a bit big. Now, tell me about the Beatles headphones.
Okay, those are two pairs of Beatles headphones that were made by the Koss Company, and they look similar in that photograph, but as a completist type collector, one set of those headphones had paper stickers that depicted the Beatles on both of the headsets there. And the other one, the stickers were made out of metal. So I tried to find both sets, and that's what they were. And they were also in the original boxes as you'd find them on a shelf at a retail center.
All right. Tell me about this one.
That is one of the drums that was put out by the Mastro Company in the United States. And that shows the drum. And obviously you can see all four of the Beatles on the drum head there. There's the instruction booklet that came along with it, the stand to put that drum on, the drumsticks, and obviously there is the display box as you would have found it on the shelf at your local store.
Amazing. Here's another one.
Same thing. The company was Mastro that put those out. They were called Beatle pinup guitars. And basically what they were a little like plastic brooch that you could put on your shirt pocket or your lapel, and they came in two different displays. The one there that I think is on your left was a easel back counter display that displayed those little plastic guitars, and then the one that's sitting on top of the cardboard box, that one would fold into a display, and it had the little pinup guitars inside of the box. And then again, that is the cardboard box that several of those boxes would have been inside of and shipped to a retail center.
Okay, that's great. Now this one.
Those are the a picture of all of the guitars and drums, and I think you might be able to look in the bottom and also see the bongos and the banjos. The display case behind there shows the guitars and the banjos after they would have been removed from their packaging. And then I was also fortunate over the years to find most all of those guitars and banjos in the original package as you would have found them in your store. And almost every single one of those drums and guitars came from two different companies, Selcol from the United Kingdom and Mastro from the United States and in Canada.
Amazing. That's amazing there, Dennis. Now, here we go.
That's just a little closer shot of the instruments as you would have found them in the original packages. Just very fortunate that I found most all of them as you would have found them back in the 1960s, still in their original package with the backing cards and the toy instruments.
Fantastic. Now, we've got the other one here.
And again, that's just the showcase showing all of the guitars and the banjos outside of their packaging. Pretty much every one of those guitars there came from the UK or the United States. And again, the companies were Selcol in the UK, Mastro in the US. And there's a few odds and ends in there that were probably unlicensed varieties that came mostly from China or Hong Kong. And then there's one super rare guitar in there that came from West Germany. And so far, it's the only one I've ever come across. So that pretty much shows most of the guitars, banjos, drums, and what have you.
Terry, that's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, and I was going to ask Pat real quick, on one of his photos, did I see a slot machine down in there in the lower?
Yeah, there's a yellow submarine, one-arm bandit, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So we're coming up to that now. Pat, these photos are your place, that's right?
No, that's mine.
Okay, that's you, guy, is it?
Yes, that's my rec room.
Fantastic. All right. Let's go through them slowly.
Well, I mean, you can see the disco cases there in the top middle. You can see the blow up dolls in the frames there on the left. The drum with the picture of Ringo on that you had mentioned before there on the bottom right. There's a butcher cover album on the wall there. That's the rec room.
Okay, we'll just keep it going.
Yep, that's one of the corners of the rec room. I'm sitting at that table right now, but I moved it. My background is not that display case, but in the rec room there's six different display cases altogether with the Beatles memorabilia.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the one that that I'm sitting in front of right now. On the right there is all the stuff from the Standard Plastics products company from New Jersey. Yeah.
We're still gone.
Yep, and that's the other corner of the room. And you can see those are my 78 RPMs there on the wall from the Philippines and the UK. And
Pat, I just want to ask, this is still yours?
Yes, that's mine. That's what you're seeing in the background when you're showing me live right now.
Fantastic. Now just continue. God, just tell me if we miss it.
Right. That's yeah. That's one of the ones in the corner there.
That's a close up.
Uh huh. That's more of a close up one. And right. And that one too. You can see the gumball machine down there in the bottom right. That's a good one.
That's a great one. Now, I'm going to continue in a moment, but do us a favor now, Guy. Just stand up for a second and just pan your computer and show everyone what's behind you. We're all fascinated.
Okay, well. I mean, you could see there, those the Kabuto kits, the wallet, the notebooks, the pencil cases, those all came from the same company, Standard Plastic Products. So that's kind of what I was working on collecting this year. And then if you go over to that side, you know, that's the stuff from Airflight. And let's see if I can pan over this way. Then you see in the whole, you know, the whole room that you just showed the pictures of.
It's amazing when you see the real thing, isn't it? Thank you for showing that guy. Now, I just want to continue on.
Right.
That's this one here is the continuation of your room, guy.
Yeah, that's the Standard Plastic Products items. They made the caboodle kits, the wallets, the notebooks, and the pencil cases in different colors. Now, that is not mine.
Okay, whose is that?
Yeah, that one's mine. Where you can see the second shelf on from the top there. We've got the Beatles UK lamp with a lampshade on, and the Soakies, the Colgate Soakies, either side of it in the corner there. Ringo and Paul. They only did Ringo and Paul. I think they seem to be the most popular in the US when they came out, and poor old George and John never got a Soakie made of themselves. So and the shelf, there's my glasses collection, or part of my glasses collection, as well as the lunch boxes up there at the top, the yellow submarine lunch box done by and blue one done by Aladdin. And then different the glasses on the third shelf down there on the right hand side, the four headshots were actually done in Portugal. They're quite difficult to get a set of those glasses.
Well, I got to say, a lot of people are going to Britain. They're going overseas, aren't they? A lot of people are living in Spain and different places, including Portugal.
Yeah,
aren't they, Pat? Yeah.
And the ones on the left hand side with the red headshots, they were done in the Netherlands. So a real mixture of different manufacturers. The jelly glasses there on the second shelf from the USA, and the ones on the right hand side there, done in Holland at the side of the coloured jelly glasses. So a real mixture.
Fantastic. We'll just keep it moving now.
Yeah, a little bit of old rock and roll music display, albeit from the 70s, tops it off. But down there in the bottom, you got the UK jigsaws on the top shelf, the set of four jigsaws, plus the purses that Guy was talking about. And then below that, you've got the Royal Dalton Toby jugs. Of the Beatles. There were four done originally, and then when John died, they did a special version again with a different coloured coat there in the middle with a red and yellow on.
Now, Pat, I need to ask you for the porcelain, right? I had the milk jug for that. How hard is it to get the milk jug?
Ah, well, that's a bit of a strange one. The Washington Pottery ones. It doesn't appear the milk jug was done over here in the UK.
Mike said Liverpool underneath.
Yeah, I think that's a later version that was done after the 60s. I'm not quite sure when, but there's quite a few different things done.
Pat, could it be fake? I need to ask you. Do you think it was fake?
Yeah, I think it's. I don't think it's original 60s anyway. I think it's a reproduction that was done probably in the 80s. It would be my guess.
Okay, I don't know. That's what I'm asking you. But here's another one there. What's that?
Yeah, so we've got the box of very difficult to get that box. I've only just managed to get it recently with the guitar brooches. The guitar brooches are common with the cards, but try and find a box to put them in the original display box. And then at the front of that, I've got the almost the set of the candy sticks that was done. I've got five out of the six that sit in front of the in the box there. Very hard to get. Picked those up from Perry Cox recently. Been after those for years. So one of my holy grail holes filled. And then of course you got the little nodders done by Carl Moscot in the middle. And hiding behind that is probably my my pride and joy, which I don't know if you can see that, the Beatles colour inset.
Yeah, I'll just take it off now, Joe. I've got a picture of that actually here. I just want to ask you, for those nodders with the gold, there's the Beatle colouring set there. Those nodders with the gold, where are they made?
They were made by Killfix in the UK.
Okay, what did they come out, 64?
I'm not quite sure what, they're about 64 they were.
Okay.
I know
someone who's got a set of those. What are they worth, just roughly? I'm not holding you to the price.
Well, mine's a sealed box, and I paid a lot of money for it. I paid 2,500 UK pounds for it. But it only...
Well, that's great.
Came up about 15 years ago, and I missed it and vowed I'd never miss it again. So,
right, whose is that one?
That one's mine again.
Tell us about that pack.
On the top shelf there, you've got the Beatles diary that was done in 1964. There's a complete set of all the diaries in the original display box, which was very difficult to find. Even to find the display box, the diaries are quite common, but to get a full set in a display box, bit hard to come across. And then on the shelf below, just on the left hand side, you just make out the four figures. They are the glass Christmas ornaments that were done in Italy in four different colors. And then moving down the shelf, you can just about see the boxes of the Hard Day's Night gum card boxes and the display boxes and the color USA color. And then in the middle there, a little unique thing where there were some Licorice Records made in the UK, but also were shipped out to the USA. So you have a different spelling of the Licorice. The Licorice Records in them are spelled in the English spelling, but the display box actually has the USA spelling on. So a little bit unique.
Amazing. Here we go to another one. We'll keep it moving.
Yeah, that's mine again. The right at the top there, I don't know if you can you make it out. It's a John Lennon whiskey decanter. Really nice piece, not original 60s, but a lovely piece. I picked up in the USA. Then at the bottom there, you've got the pens on the display cards done by Press Initial Corp. And then just at the back of the pens there, the box set of UK glasses done by J&L.
EP. Fantastic. Here we go. I'm just going to keep it moving now.
Yeah.
Hey, EP. EP, go. Can you go back one? Okay, right there. Notice that on the third shelf, those Soaky dolls, which are so cool. Paul Ringo there on the Soaky. Those aren't the normal colors that we get. I think Pat's got, and I think Pat and I have talked about this, he may have some prototypes back there where they got the gray suits on. That is pretty cool, EP.
Yeah, they are unusual. They're slightly smaller as well than the plastic ones. They seem to be made ceramic. They just came up out of the blue in a UK auction, and I just bidded for them recently, and as Terry knows, I managed to get them, yeah. Bit of a unique one.
Drew, that's amazing. I'm so glad you spotted that within the company there. That's unbelievable. Going back to this, Pat.
Yeah, got the on the second shelf down there, the full set of the Revel models with the done by Revel in the UK in with the boxes in the background. And then below that, the Beatles sneakers. Just missing the pink set of sneakers, but we got the blue and the white sneakers and an original box, and then a bit more of the ceramic Washington pottery selection down there on the bottom shelf, and that little bus in the middle there actually lights up. It's actually a telephone. It was just an official Apple item, but it was done much later in the 90s. But a nice item.
That's great. You can ring Apple direct.
Yeah. Oh no. One of my favourite pieces, done in West Germany by a company called Akatat, who did the cork stoppers as well. beautiful, it's like a resin guitar with the Beatles heads, as you can see them.
Right, tell me about this one.
Yeah, they're made by the same company who did the guitar. I just managed to complete the set recently. So over the moon with that. I'd had three for quite a while and finally got to George, I think it was last. Again, they're quite a large size. They look quite small on the, you know, cork stoppers, but they're huge heads on them.
Okay, now we're keeping... we're having a great time on them. How big are they? Can we see that again?
Yeah. So there you go. There's one of them. That's how big they are.
That's unbelievable. Have you ever seen anything like that guy or Dennis?
Yes.
All right, let's keep it going now. If you own this, please own up to everything I show now. Whose is that?
Yeah, that's mine. That's the UK lipstick. It's a rare old piece because I've not seen it in any of the memorabilia guides that the guys have done over the years. But it definitely exists. As you can see, there's a copy of the advert in the original UK magazine from early 1964. And there's the lipsticks.
Right. I've got to say, I love the wacky stuff. Let's keep this moving. Look at this.
Yeah, that's a close-up of the box I was talking about earlier, done by Invicta Plastics. You'd see that in your shop, and just unfortunately, millions of them will have been thrown away, but managed to grab that at last. So it displays my brooch as well.
How much is it to buy a packet like that with all the brooches in them?
Oh, wow. Well, if you could manage to find a full box, you'd be talking in the thousands, that's for sure.
Dennis, you'd be able to retire. I like this item here. I reckon that's groovy. Paul wearing the cap. That's a great cap.
Yeah. Cap done by Kangol in the UK, which is pictures of the Beatles there with the same cap on, with a little badge on the front. And original displayed some frozen peas in the UK.
Now, guys, you're going to love this item. Here we go. There we go. Tell us about that.
That's the one you were saying, yeah. Yeah. I managed to pick that up back in late 2002. It's a heavy old item. It needs three of you to move it, as you can imagine, with it being a one-armed bandit. I think you call them slots, Terry, yeah?
Yeah, Pat, did it have any money in it?
No, it didn't have a money. It's missing the coin tray, unfortunately.
Oh, no wonder. Someone got to it. Now, listen, that made the magazine. Is that right? They came and took a photo and stuck it on the magazine. Is that it?
Yeah, I sent Andrew Croft at Beatleology some information on it, and he very kindly put it on the front page of his magazine back on his Yellow Submarine edition back in 2003 and did an article on it inside for me, yeah.
Thank you, Pat. That was fantastic. Now I'm going to guess that this isn't yours, Pat. I'm going to guess maybe this is Dennis's.
It's certainly Dennis's, is that, yeah.
Is that right, Dennis? Yeah,
that's a shot of my Beatles display room.
Good. Let's keep it moving, Dennis.
Yeah, that's looking down through part of the Beatles display room that I had.
That's amazing.
There's part of the collection there. Some of the stuff that you see right there, you can see those original posters that from the Avedon art. That's there on the left. I was really fortunate to find a full display box of those. And you can't see it, but underneath there was the shipping box that they came in. So that was really quite a find. Some of the stuff you see in the background, as you were talking about earlier, some of the dishware. You know, I got a little bit of a story about some of these pieces that came out in the 80s and 90s. I was actually at a Beatles International Convention in Liverpool and London one year, and I met a gentleman. His father had the licensing for those original Washington pottery dishes. And so the son ended up with all of these decals after the fact. And I know that he used some of them to fire up coffee sets and tea sets. And I'm assuming that he probably sold some of those because of the pitchers and the basins and what have you, that I know I got mine out of Australia. I'm guessing that he must have sold some of those decals to somebody there, and they fired him onto those pieces. So that's kind of a little bit of the story behind those.
That's great, Dennis. We'll just keep it going there. You got so much stuff.
That's another picture of some of the glassware and what have you there. Up on top of there were the Chew Bops that came out. I think those came out around 1980, if I'm not mistaken. They were little bubblegum records, and they showed like the original sleeves, as you would have found the Beatles albums in the USA.
Fantastic.
Those are some of the dresses that came out in the 1960s. Kind of a story on the one that's in the front there, the one with the pink guitars. That actually has the autographs of all four Beatles on it. And then on the back side of it, it's signed by Cynthia Lennon. And supposedly the story behind that is a girl that was at the world premiere of A Hard Day's Night. And I'm not sure whether she was an usherette or just attending that film, but all four Beatles signed it across the top. And then Cynthia, John Lennon's wife, autographed it on the backside. So that's kind of a neat picture, story with that particular dress.
Dennis, I just got to say, you're very lucky they didn't sign her arms or anything. Otherwise, you wouldn't have it.
Right.
Okay, some more. Here it is.
Just some more dresses, some more different styles. Those are the dresses that obviously featured the polka dots on there. And they came out in several different colors. I thought it was kind of odd that one of them there, and I think it's the, you can't really see it in the back, but you see the one with the black and white. There was also one that came out that had the black and white on the back side and the blue and white on the front side. So I always thought that was kind of an oddity. But also you can see there's kind of the mustard color and the pink and the blue and the black and the pillows and stuff that you see down underneath there were things that came out later on.
Amazing.
Store displays, and that kind of depicts store displays all the way from the beginning through the post-Beatle era. Probably some of them that stand out in there. There's an original one for Beatles 6, which was a USA release album. There's the motion display is in there for Help. There's a motion display back there for the Yellow Submarine. Display for the Hey Jude album, for the Abbey Road album. There's also one that you can see clear in the back there that's pretty rare. It was actually for the White album. And then some of the other ones like the UK phone booth one, that was a display for some trading cards that came out post-Beatles. And you can also see a little Christmas display back there where you see the Beatles dressed in like Santa suits. And that featured albums, early Capitol albums, Beatles 65, early Beatles. So that pretty much kind of shows what you got there. There's another picture looking down a hallway in the display room. And obviously those rugs that were on the floor, they came out post-Beatles. These are original RIAA gold and platinum record awards. The early ones are those with the white matte finish on the back of them. The ones with the dark came out after the fact. And I tried to just collect ones that were presented to the Beatles themselves. And the story always is, well, how did you get one that belonged to the Beatles? Well, they made more than just the four that they handed out to John, Paul, George, and Ringo. There was a lot of them that also said presented to the Beatles, in which they would give so many to each one of them, and they could do what they wanted with their families or what have you. And over the years, people would auction them off or sell them or what have you. And I picked all of them up one at a time. So again, always the thrill of the hunt.
Dennis, I love this. I don't know how you did this, but you got the cavern at your house, yeah?
Right. Yeah, you know, as the display grew over the years, I mean, it went from one room to another, to another, to another. And when we put an addition on the house, 20 odd years ago, we did part of that with the idea of putting that display room in there. And then as an afterthought, I thought, how cool would it be to have a miniature cavern club in there? So we, at the end of the backside of that display room there, we decided to go ahead and build a cavern club. And as you can see, it's got the arched brick ceiling in it. And we put the little stage in there. I tried my best to copy that back wall as close as I could to what the original looked like in the cavern club there in Liverpool. And then I had the instruments. They did not belong to the Beatles. That's always a question, but they were the same models. And obviously the classic Ludwig drum set that Ringo played. And I also picked up the suits from Russ Leese. Most people might know him. He's another well-known collector and a lot of the clothing type stuff. So those were all modeled from the original collarless suits that the Beatles had. And I put together some posable mannequins with the Beatle heads on them. And, well, you see what it ended up as.
Hey, Dennis, I'm going to ask, is this what happened? Because if I had that at my house, this is what I'd do. I'd have the Beatles there, and I'd wire it for sound. I'd have big, giant speakers behind the Beatles or in the wall. And when somebody walked into the house, I'd just flick the switch and the lights would go on. They come out of the black and there you go with Twist and Shout.
We think alike then.
Hey, can I ask a question? Can I ask a question?
Yeah, go for it, Guy.
Yeah, in Terry's book, there was one of the memorabilia items, the skateboard. And I've never seen that in these great collections that, you know, of these collectors. Does anyone have that, the skateboard?
I never knew of a collector any place that ever did find one. And that picture, I think, is the only picture that ever existed, you know, of it.
So perhaps they advertised it, but never actually sold them?
Pardon me?
You think perhaps they advertised the skateboard, but never actually ended up selling and distributing them?
I do believe that happened. I think they got licensed for it. And obviously they made at least one. That you see in the pictures. But if you read about that, supposedly that skateboard was also going to be in four different sizes, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Right. There were several models.
And to me, I always thought the box that it came in was a lot more attractive than the skateboard itself. But to the best of my knowledge, I don't know of anyone that ever actually found one. That
was always I never at the saw top one
of
either.
My list of something to find, and I never did find one.
There's a story.
All right, can I just add to that if I can? It might have some credence, right? But there's a photo of John Lennon in a part of his house that's like cemented in three open walls, and he's on an actual skateboard. Now I'm thinking that they might have been selling the skateboards and he got one, and that's why we were skating there. I'm serious. And this, I reckon, is about 1965. Have you seen that photo?
I have seen that photo, EP. I do not believe he's on that skateboard, but I have seen that photo. But what a cool segue it would have been if they could have did the skateboard and showed.
Well, can you imagine John Lennon skating and he had the four Beatles with the speakers playing the music at night?
EP, there's a story somewhere, EP, about that skateboard that I just can't uncover.
Yeah, but now that we're talking this and we're having a really good discussion, I've got a question for everybody. Who has the set of the wacky plaques? The ones that are the cardboard, you pin them onto each other and you hang them from a door. Who had those?
If you're talking about the Plax cards that were put out by the Topps company.
Yeah, that's right. That's what I'm talking about. Wacky Plax. Yeah,
I had a full set of those and the display box. And it was very difficult to put an entire collection of those together. So maybe one of these guys will end up with it at some point. But I did have the display box and I did have all of those cards. So.
Fedigam, I reckon they sold it in Australia here and they sold the Beetle cards. I'm just saying, we didn't get, most of our stuff came from the UK, believe it or not, in the 60s. It didn't come from the States. We got everything from Britain. They just brought it across selling merchandise.
Yeah, you did a cool belt over there. Have you seen that cookie belt? Plastic, the black belt with the white. They did a white version, 64, when they were touring over there. It came from Australia. I managed to pick one up recently. A real nice belt with a black belt, but with white pictures of the Beatles on.
I've never seen the belt, but I'll tell you what, before they came to tour here in Australia, they had apples at Australia House in the UK, and it made the women's magazine. I don't know if you collected magazines as well, but let me tell you, and Guy knows, only Guy knows, you've got a very special collectible there, haven't you, Guy?
Oh, yes, because I brought this one out for you, EP, because I know you're also a monkeys collector. This one's in my collection too.
Yeah, can you bring that up to the screen, please, Guy?
Pardon me?
Bring it closer in up to the camera. Yeah. Bring it in. Yeah. There you go. Now I'm going to ask you a serious question now. Hardcore Beetle collectors like yourself, which are super Beetle collectors, right? You're monkey fans, aren't you, as well, aren't you? Tell me the truth.
Of course.
Yeah. I think the vast majority of Beetle fans were also monkey fans because we grew up with both of them. And then we had the monkeys every week on television, just like we had the Beatles cartoons every week on television. So, you know, we grew up with them, not only listening to them on the radio, but we got to catch them every week on TV, both of them.
Now, that's fantastic coming from you guys. I just want to say, I did an interview today with Andrew Sandoval. He's got a book, which is called The Monkeys, The Day-to-Day Story. First came out in 2005, I believe. Now it's been rewritten and he's got a special deluxe version coming out. Go on the net, check it out. And I've ordered my copy, and all the Beatle fans out there, I want you to look up Andrew Sandoval, The Monkeys Day-to-Day Story. There's a super deluxe edition. I want you to check that out, everybody. And that's just basically, everyone knows about it from like today to order before March. So I want people to check it out because not only does he write about the monkeys, he actually writes about the Beatles. And he says there was a lot of camaraderie between them and the monkeys really liked the Beatles, but the Beatles really liked the monkeys. Now, I just want to say, guys, it's been such a fascinating episode today. You agree, Terry? I want Terry to say something about the episode.
Well, the episode is always great. I think it's so interesting, and Dennis brought this up. I think it's so interesting. Actually, these guys do a wonderful job. They've got great collections, and they just keep going. But how hard it is sometimes to distinguish what you're doing and how cool it is to do the research. Because like Dennis says, on some of that Washington pottery, he's got 1964 decals on a 1970 or 1980 piece. So, you know, is half of the piece is a 1960s or a third of it or something like that. It gets very hard to distinguish sometimes between stuff like that. So I'm just sitting here like a kid in a candy store watching these guys.
Well, I just want to say I'm blown away. And if Dennis would be kind enough to tell him a few years ago, Dennis, tell him the story. You brought in the auction house, what you did. They went through your stuff and they gave you an idea on the price of valuation. Just tell me how many years it took you to collect your entire collection, and then tell me what they valued your collection at.
Well, like I said, the very first piece I ever bought in my entire life was I Want to Hold Your Hand, the 45 RPM record. I bought that in 1964. I actually bought it before they even were on Ed Sullivan. So that's what started it for me. That song is what started it for me, period. And so I became an instant Beatle fanatic and have been my entire life. And probably the second thing that I ever picked up would have been the bubblegum cards back in the day. But I consciously probably started collecting memorabilia after I found a couple of pieces at a flea market in the very early 1970s. And so that just really set things into motion for me after that. And so I guess you can obviously say I've been collecting the Beatles since I Want to Hold Your Hand was released. And when Heritage sent their people out to check my collection out and to kind of go through it and see what they thought it the whole thing in totality was worth, they were talking somewhere in the neighborhood of $2 to $3 million.
Wow. I've got to say, this is why we got the show with the Super Beatles collectors here. As I said, not everyone's in that league, but let me tell you, it doesn't matter what you actually collect. And being a Monkees collector, I have the rarest Beatle comic in the world, as you know, right? One of them, Del number one edition, 1964, in very nice condition. And it's the export version. It's not the 35-cent that's sold in America. It's the one that's 2 shillings 7 pence. So for someone that's been collecting Monkees memorabilia all their life, that wasn't a bad pickup, was it, guys?
You did well.
Pretty good. Doing well there, yeah.
And I got to tell you, because I like you guys so much, right? You're not going to believe this. That's my Monkees poster. Took me 53 years to get it signed by all four Monkees. 53 years. I bought it when I was about becoming 9 years old in 1967. It was Hollywood personality posters. And I said, 53 years to get it. And I know, and I'm going to ask you now individually, and I'll start with you, Dennis. What is your most cherished, most prized Beatle collectible that you have sold or you still own it? What is it?
Oh, man. You know, I don't know. I had a lot of pieces that were very special to me. I really loved the Meet the Beatles motion display that I had. That was probably by far my favorite of all the displays. I always loved the Tory instruments. I loved the guitars and the drums. They meant a lot to me. Obviously, everybody likes the record player or the phonograph, what have you. There was just so many different pieces in the collection. It's like trying to, you know, tell somebody who your favorite child is. It was very tough. I loved all of it. I did.
Fantastic. Guy, what is your most prized possession that you have or sold or whatever?
Well, I'll say, and you can see it in the top right corner now, the loot tray it's called. And that's my favorite because that was one of the first things I got. And I got it at a flea market for $14. And they always sell for like over $1,000 now. But that was one of my great finds because I found it at an outdoor flea market sitting on a blanket.
Now, Pat, from the UK, what is your price position? And don't tell me it's a licorice because I know it's not the licorice.
No, it's not the licorice. No, it's not the licorice. But it would be this guitar I was talking about earlier.
Wow.
It's not the most expensive piece I've paid for, but it was one of the rarest, so difficult to find in really good condition. So, yeah, that was
mine. It's bigger than I would have expected, that's for sure, now that you're holding it up.
Yeah,
I'll be honest with you. If you put that in a tree, you wouldn't recognize what it is. I'm dead set. And the corks as well. If you stuck them in a tree, they're camouflaged. I'll tell you that now.
With a corpse as well.
Now, listen, everybody, I want to thank you so much. It's been a really fantastic show. I mean, where do you get a show like this? Super Beatles collectors from all over the world. Just what, you know, I just take my hat off to you. What a collection. All you guys have done to collect your lives, to do what you've done and own what you do. So from Plastic EP, I'd like to thank Guy Smith, Dennis Daly, Pat Graham, and, of course, the great Terry Crane. Make sure you get his book. Where's your book, Terry?
Why, look, EP, I happen to have it in my hand. It's the second edition. So
yeah, tell them where they can get it.
Well, you can get it now. If you're in the U.S., you can get it out on Barnes & Noble and Amazon. And if you're in over 60 countries, on tradition.com. Get out there and take care of it. And a lot of these guys, all of these guys have contributed something to the book, which I think is just amazing that we have such a great group of collectors that will help out in that way.
Now, can I just gotta tell people that that's the expanded edition.
That's right.
Can I say something about
Jimmy? Yeah, of course,
collector. To be a collector, you need somebody to tell you what's missing and give you information. And there's been some great books written over the years. But I have to say, when I came across Terry's book, some of the things that some doors he opened, some things he told me that after 35, 40 years collecting, I didn't know. It's been a mutual appreciation society, really, and a fantastic book. One of the best, I think, that's ever been done on Beatles collecting. So thanks, Terry.
Thank you, Pat. And EP, I'm going to say, EP, hold on. Pat has the Beatlebilia website, Beatlebilia.com. If you ever are out there, go to that, because it just goes and goes and goes. And it's amazing, page after page. So there's the man right there.
As I said, the world salutes you guys. Thanks again for being on this program. It's going to go everywhere. It's every Beatles site out there on the net. And they're going to love it. Yeah. And they're going to love what you've been collecting. So thanks again. All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great being with these great guys.
Cheers. Thanks, guys.